Please stand up. Breathing. Fast. Quickly, quickly, quickly. Yeah, just get some blood running to your legs. Yeah, sit down again. Thank you. My name is Tapan. I am an engineer by profession. I am a dancer by passion. I work in Nomura because that's a choice. And I am a seeker because that's my nature and I don't have any other choice. Neither of us do, right? That's why all of y'all have gone through this grueling day and you are still waiting over here and you are still smiling. So please give yourself a good shout out. I have my special reasons to make you all clap because clapping activates the nervous system and what we are talking over here is something which is very profound. And from my vast experience, I want you kids to understand what I'm talking. So yeah, without wasting any other time, I'll start. There are three aspects of life. The Jiva, the Jagat and the Ishvara. Jiva is the individual. The Jagat is the world, and the Ishvara is what we say is the creator. Who made these three aspects? The Jiva cannot create another Jiva. The individual cannot create an individual, right? The world cannot create the world. The world cannot create the individual. And the individual cannot create the world. An individual does thus give birth to an individual, but that is procreation. There's a reason why it is called procreation and not creation. The parent cannot create the Atma of the child. It just gives it the gross form. The Atma was something which has always existed. But then who created that Atma? Science tells us that everything is a permutation and combination of five elements that just people told us. But is it true? Just those five elements have created the Atma? Okay, fine. Mangliya. Who created those five elements? So this endless quest, that conflict between science and Vedanta, and it's an endless quest that human race has started. And it's endless because it is endless. No one has still found out the answers. But Vedanta does come close and you will see it from the speakers who I have to follow. There are 24 aspects of life that Adi Shankaracharya has introduced in the shloka that goes as such. Atha chaturvimshati tatva utpatti prakaram
vakshyamaha.
Atha, the literal meaning of Atha means now. But in Vedanta, whenever we say Atha, it implies a change of topic. So right now we are going, we have seen ascertained that whatever we have seen so far is the true nature of the self. We have handled the individual aspect. Now we are going on to the world to understand what this world is made of. We know that I am Satchitanand, but what is the world is what comes right now. And while science tells us that it's just the five elements, Vedanta, Adi Shankaracharya says Chaturvimshati. There are 24 aspects that actually make up this whole world around us. And those 24 include the 5 elements, the 5 sense organs, that is the organs of perception, the 5 organs of action, and then the 5 pranas, 20, and the 4 thought modifications. Now these thought modifications are very special. They have a very special degree of an MBA and a CA. And which we have put together and we call it MBCA. Can anyone of you tell me the full form of MBCA?
Manbuddhi Chitta Nahankar.
But before we see what these 24 elements are, what this world is made up, there is a very important concept that defines the very distinction between science and Vedanta. Science has limitations. Because whatever we perceive, our sense organs, we see this world and we believe that this world is real. But when we are dreaming, we think that the dream world is real until we wake up, right? So whatever we see and perceive has its limitations. And that is why science cannot be the backbone on which we can understand what this creation is actually made up of. And that is when Vedanta comes in and it says that a concept which is the most widely misunderstood, misinterpreted word in the whole world and still it is most widely used, and that word is Maya. Exam ke ek din pehle padhna nahi hai kyu are yaar exam se rahe bade ka moh aaya then agar bachcha ro raha hai maa pareshan why maa ki maya. So all these concepts, let us see how Adi Shankaracharya has defined, introduced Maya rather, in Tattva world.
Now
no repetition, continue. You chant it and you remember. Yeah.
Brahma Ashraya. ब्रह्म आश्रय सत्व रजस तमो गुणात्मिका माया अस्ति ब्रह्म आश्रय दैट विच डिपेंड्स अपॉन ब्राह्मण सत्व रजस गुणात्मिका दैट विच इज ऑफ द नेचर ऑफ द क्वालिटीज ऑफ सत्व रजस एंड तमस विच आर द थ्री गुणस माया अस्ति इज माया वी हैव सीन and we have associated with the absolute truth as Brahman. But Brahman we know is changeless, formless, attributeless. So how can something which is changeless create something which is ever changing? It's a paradox in itself, right? And that is when Maya comes in. Maya, Brahman does not create the world. Brahman uses its power, which is called as Maya, and then Brahman takes the identity of Ishwara, and Ishwara creates the world. Is how Maya has been introduced over here. Maya is a power, and these powers are of two types. One is Avaran Shakti, and one is the Vikshepa Shakti. So as this we can do example like Vatsal had pointed out, for us, it can be a rope right now because we are aware of it, that it's a rope. But some others might, everyone perceives everything in a separate way. So for me, it's a rope. For you, it might be a snake. For someone else, it might be a branch of a tree. And the same person who saw it as a rope today will see it as a snake tomorrow. So our perceptions are very different and varied. And that is when we say that the concept that it has brought about ignorance in you that this is not a rope and it's a snake, that is the Avaran Shakti or the Veiling Power. It is bringing about ignorance in you that this is not a rope but this is something else. Similarly, how can you be so sure that this world that you are seeing is real because it is a mere projection. But ignorance in itself does not have the power to create. The world cannot come out of ignorance, right? So then comes the second type of power that says it's a creative power or the Vikshepa Shakti or the projection. That power is what projects the rope as a snake and then you can see it and perceive it. So this creative power in our Hindu tradition, we also call it as Shakti. Moving on, there are two standpoints. One is the absolute standpoint. From the absolute standpoint, there is no world at all. Everything that we see is an illusion. The etymological meaning of Maya can be understood by actually reversing it. Ya ma so Maya means that which is not but appears to be and only seems to be. So the reflection of the sun in the water does not mean that that is the sun. It's a reflection. Similarly, we can say that this world that we are seeing is actually a reflection of the Brahman. That is the absolute truth, the absolute reality. And science assumes that this world is real and all its assumptions, it has gone down to the micro levels, it's gone to atom, electron, proton, neutron, quartz, plasma, it keeps on going, and even the higher level, solar system, galaxy, nebula, we still don't know even 1% of the universe that we are living in. And so what Vedant says that this is relatively real, this is not real, the absolute truth is Brahman. And in this comparison, then Maya was defined as the three gunas of the nature of the three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. There can be an analogy made in the recent festival that just went by Navaratri. First 3 days we worship Durga. Durga Ma killed Mahishasur. Mahisha it means a buffalo and buffalo stands for laziness. So we come out of our tamoguna, we come out of tamas in the first 3 days. The next 3 days we worship Lakshmi. Lakshmi is for wealth. So that is the rajasic aspect. So we move on from tamas to rajas. And then in the last 3 days we worship Saraswati and that is the sattva guna, the sattvic aspect. And after all the nine days, we celebrate Dasera. And that is when we become one with the absolute truth. So this is how you actually transcend Maya from sattva, rajas, tamas. If you are able to transcend all of these three gunas and then finally transcend Maya, we become liberated and become one. So that is it. Maya is a very, very huge topic to cover and whatever has been in the text I managed to cover so far. And thank you for listening patiently and being for here so far. And there are quite a few interesting speakers still waiting to left. And I would urge you to please stay back because by the end of the session, some of us might actually become enlightened. And even if those who don't, we will get to witness enlightenment. So please stay back.